How's it going? This is Sherrod with Sherrod Sports Visas, and today we're getting started on our series on P1 visas and O1 visas, and today we are focusing on the P1. Now, if you are completely unfamiliar, the P1 is the most common visa category for foreign athletes to come and compete in the United States, while the O1 is the other one that a lot of athletes get. And I'm going to tell you why maybe you should be going for the P1 instead of the O1, since this particular series is on the P1 visa. Well, there's one really big reason why you should get a P1 over an O1 is that on eligibility, that means if you are eligible for the visa, it's much easier on P1 on most cases than the O1. That's because on P1, there's about 7 categories that you have to prove to, and most of them are very objective. Either you have them or you don't. For example, if you have an international ranking, you have that or you don't. If you have national championships, you either have that or you don't. Also, the same as if you've competed in a previous major league or if you've competed with an NCAA collegiate team or a national team. It's most of those things, you either have it or you don't. Unlike the O1, where it's more subjective to say, like, hey, do you have awards that have international significance? Or have you made original contributions to your field that are considered tremendous? They're more objective, which means that there's room for interpretation of whether you have met that category or not. And the P1 is not, that's usually not the case so much. Either you have those eligibility or you don't. And for that reason, a lot of athletes are just, you know, pretty much if it's presented properly, pre-qualified for that P1, say, for example, if they swam for their national team and also went to college in the United States, then on eligibility, you are pretty straightforward for a P1 visa if presented properly. Some of the other advantage of the P1 is that you can get it for 5 years. In most sports and circumstances, we recommend getting the first one for 3 years and then maybe renewing for 5 years. But that 5-year option is available as opposed to the O1 visa, which only has three years of eligibility at a time. Now, we need to talk about the limitations of the P1 visa. One is you're only supposed to use it to compete, right? It's not suitable if you're going to be coaching or if you're going to be doing seminars and things of that nature. If you are going to be doing a little bit of that, maybe it's going to be okay as saying, say, for example, if you're doing things for your sponsor or if it's just a small part of what you do in addition to competing. But on the P1, you're only supposed to be using it to compete and then kind of train and do stuff for those competitions. You're not supposed to be coaching. You're not supposed to be opening your own business or, you know, clothing line and things like that. That is more appropriate for the O1 visa. Secondly, and this is very important, and some reason why the P1 visa can be tough, is that the events that you're going to compete in have to require the participation of internationally recognized athletes. And that is something that becomes increasingly more of a problem issue area in the P1 visa, because it's kind of hard to say, you know, if you're in the NBA, it's pretty straightforward to say like, hey, yeah, we need international recognized athletes. But say if you're a rodeo person and, you know, you're just doing small shows, it's harder to show it. Or if you're going to compete in a new league that has never had a season before, it can be pretty problematic to show that this new league requires the participation of internationally recognized athletes. And we're probably going to be putting some content out there on how we address those issues and get them solved. But that's one thing to know. Like, not only do you need to be eligible for the P1 visa by satisfying 2 of the 7 categories, but you also need an itinerary that has events that require the participation of internationally recognized athletes. And this can be problematic in sports where usually you're affiliated with a certain league. Say, for example, we do a lot of visas for unsigned combat sports athletes in boxing and MMA. Most of the time it's fine to base that itinerary on leagues that you're not signed to yet, especially if you have an agent that regularly sends athletes to those leagues. But this can be, you know, pretty problematic if you're a basketball player and you want to use that P1 to play in the NBA, but you don't have an NBA contract yet. Theoretically, we think that it's fine to do that. And we actually have some litigation we're going to be doing this year to kind of figure that question out for sure. But it's just something to think about when looking at the P1 as a limitation, is that you have to have events that require the participation of internationally recognized athletes. And also you might want to have some type of relationship with those events that you plan to compete in, if it's a sport that usually requires that. And one of the other drawbacks is that if you have staff that you need to bring with you, like coaches, trainers, business managers, and that sort of thing, when they do their P1S essential support staff visa, more than likely they're only going to get 1 year on that first petition, but then you can go ahead and renew it for the remaining time left on the principal athlete's visa. So in a nutshell, that's why the P1 might be better than the O1. It's because the eligibility is easier, but the limitations are you can only be coming to compete. It should only be for events that require the participation of internationally recognized athletes, and the support staff only gets usually 1 year on their first petition.